I'm Richard Porter.
I'm Johnny Smith.
And this is Smith & Sniff, a podcast in which two friends talk about cars and this week, dad rituals.
I think we should just start off by saying hi to Joe Biden, should we?
Hi, Joe Biden.
Hi,
welcome.
Joe. Hey, Joe. Where are you going to go without that gun in your hand? Da, 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 da. I'm going down to shoot the old lady. No, you're not. I caught her breaking into the White House with a Viking helmet. Da, 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 da. No. I wonder what Joe Biden drives. Because obviously...
He's got a Corvette.
Of course he has. Of course he has. Like a C2. It's
yeah,
an early one, isn't
which
it?
Which I think he's had from new, yeah.
And I didn't... I've heard this a few times over the years, but I didn't realise that the stigma of Corvette drivers still remains in the States as being sort of old white man's car. I didn't realise it was very much like that.
Yeah, I guess it is, isn't it? I mean...
I've heard it in a few films, and I know a few people that own Corvettes, and there's definitely a thing where you've got to be of the older type. In fact, you've got to be basically Joe Biden to drive a Corvette.
Are you looking forward to the mid-engined Corvette coming to the UK, which it will at some point, apparently?
I think it's going to be a good car. I mean, the last two have been really good cars. They don't get much of a look in the UK. But
well, this is the problem. I mean, talk about the image in the US is one thing, but the image here, I always think there's something just, I don't know, irredeemably sort of off about having a Corvette in the UK. Well, I don't know whether it's because you've willfully ignored what else you could have.
I think there's two things. You either look like a lost gumballer or like a pretend kind of Americana enthusiast, you know, who just buy... We've had this chat before about people that just buy everything American because they like a lot of American culture, whereas, you know, yes, I've got a couple of American cars, but I don't necessarily, like, live the American life. So there's that. I mean, Vets have always been incredible value for money. You've never been able to buy a right-hand drive one, have you? Pretty sure
I think that's why the sort of they feel a bit off having one in the UK is because you've ignored lots of very, very good sports cars that you could have that are conveniently made in right-hand drive,
like logical suggestion cars, yeah,
and that you can get from a dealer in any reasonably sized town. because a lot of the time they're not even officially imported, are they? You've got to seek them out. You've got to go to that place in Manchester or something to get one.
That's right.
And it's left-hand drive, and it's sort of... Or until they started shrinking them down again, they're scaled a bit wrong for the UK.
Yeah,
and so it just feels like you've gone through all of these hoops because you really, really wanted a Corvette rather than, say, I mean,
I'd like that.
Is a 911 or an Audi R8 or something front engine that's good and sporty like an SL or a Jag XK or F type or something.
It's kind of it's one of those cars where I want someone else to be buying them, so I see them now and again. I'd really like my dad to like WhatsApp me today to say, listen, I've just thrown caution to the wind. Your mother and I haven't got the money, but I've just ordered a Corvette. And I would have a tear in my eye of joy and be going, Dad, A, please don't drive it too hard because you will fully lose control. But B, it'd be like, oh, great, we've got a Corvette in the family. I've got a mad old dad who's just bought a Vette, who's never driven anything quicker than a Volvo 850 T5, and he's just gone straight. But no, I kind of like Vettes. I don't know if it should be mid-engined. You know, people are very protective over the purism of a shape or a genre. Yeah. In fact, I had this exact thing when reviewing the Mach-E. There's a whole tribe of people that just can't get beyond the name and the black pony on the badge on the bonnet. And then there's another school of people that I'm in now who are like, you know what, it's not that big a deal, is it, really?
It's not that big a deal. It's Ford's name. They can do with it as they damn well please. If this is the most upsetting thing in your life, then count yourself fucking lucky.
Well, also, I said, do you know what? There's been terrible bastardisation of badges way beyond that. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, come on. I kind of thought to myself, well, hang on. I mean, Dodge are currently building a Charger that's a frumpy four-door saloon. You're like, I'm a bit pissed off about that, and I've been for a while. When they built the Challenger, which is beautifully proportioned and it's just universally handsome, So why make the four-door look like some sort of like horrible kind of grotty B-side when it didn't have to be, did it? But no,
I don't know. I don't think as four-door saloons go, it's not a bad-looking car, but that's the thing.
But it shouldn't be, Rich. That's the point. As a Charger owner, I do feel like it shouldn't have ever been a four-door.
But if you were a Mustang owner, what would you be saying about the Mach-E?
Well, depends if you're old school or new school, I think. I think if I was new school, I'd be like, yeah, they're just broadening out the brand and they're widening the appeal, and Ford have got to stay in business and they're pretty slow at reacting to trends these days. If I was old school Stang, I don't know. Well, if I was old school Stang, I'd look like Joe Biden probably, so I don't know. I'd just be taking pills for my heart or something instead.
Well, you'd probably try to claim that was authentic because Carroll Shelby was on pills for his heart his whole life.
Oh, yeah. And, well, that is authentic then, isn't it? Heart pills.
Yeah, very authentic. Heart pills. So we should do Mustang branded.
So we've got, obviously we've been a bit political, and I've said it before, I would love. I haven't watched the Trump and the Joe Biden kind of the inauguration parade, but I was really hoping to see a sort of fast, slightly out of control Mustang exiting Cars and Coffee. You know, the Shelby oh shit snake.
Well, I mean, you know, Britain has the Red Arrows, and various other countries have their own aerial formation teams, including the US. But what if the Americans went one step further and had a formation Mustang leaving Cars and Coffee's team? Of course, it wouldn't really be in formation, would it? Or would they beautifully all lost control in sync and hit a series of evenly spaced lampposts?
No, it would be a series of evenly spaced Camrys. It would just be amazing. Oh, yeah. It's always an innocent but immaculate car that cops the worst of it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. It's usually a Camry or a Jetta. It's clearly
and
been
it's
looked
parked
after.
At the side of the road, and it's in park, and it's an auto, so it's locked in gear, and the wheels are really close to the curb, so it just smears it up the curb and snaps the alloys in that horrible way. I think the formation Mustang leaving Cars and Coffee social event, I think I would pay really good money to watch that.
And now the cast and crew of The Lion King will take to the stage to sweep up all the shards of plastic and broken headlights.
I think Ken Block is missing a trick here. The next Jim Carter, it needs to be leaving the car park in a Mustang Carna, and it obviously special appearance by somebody like Donald Trump, which is strictly one-handed driving because he's waving the whole time with the other hand, despite being hugely out of control, still waving.
Do you remember when we went to that? We got invited to go to a pitch meeting or a brainstorm for a pitch for a car thing that some friends of ours were trying to make, and they were pitching to a car company to make them some viral films or something. And they said, "Hey, you two should come down and help out with the ideas." And we came up with this thing. Was it Ben Cock? And he was a Ken Block style stunt driver, but he was a bit sloppy and he kept reversing into shit or just overcooking it and losing control.
It's like goes to handbrake turn, but it's always just an understeer with locked up rears.
Yeah.
It's not quite the same, is it?
And the panel damage that results is always light. Like, he never totals the car, but he really does scuff it up. And I remember sitting there going, and he's called Ben Cock, and they just looked at us like,
this can't happen.
I don't think this is what they're looking for, but we'll write it down. They did that thing that you might do to a small child. That's great. We'll just write that down here. And you're thinking, that's going to be ripped off the whiteboard as soon as we leave
the
room.
Yeah, they take it straight off. The post-it goes under the desk and they're screwing it up while they're addressing the class. Yeah. Anyway. Oh, I know a very big welcome we need to make on the podcast. Please welcome Stellantis. Featuring PSA and FCA. Remix.
I haven't got an air horn to hand.
Exactly. Put your hands in the air. Come on, Stellantis. I've got images in my head of Guru Josh Infinity playing in the background with lasers going through the fog and the Stellantis
So many lasers.
And of course air horns and people wearing, I don't know, strange hats.
Yeah. So Stellantis has a quite saucy blonde female singer who appears with them. But I also think they have a shirtless male saxophone player who pops up and sort of parps annoyingly across the top
He's the head of product for the new artist formerly known as FCA and PSA. Yeah.
FCA in the house.
Stellantis. They sound so Euro, don't they? They're so Euro.
Such a Euro dance act from the late 90s, I think.
Mid to late 90s. Definitely. So
I can hear Gary Davis, though, sort of going, okay, now straight in at number six in this week's top ten, Stellantis with The Sound of Freedom.
Is that what it is? I was just going to say, what's their debut hit? The Sound of Freedom.
So those kind of dance tracks back then always had sort of slightly kind of quasi-mystical but ultimately meaningless titles, didn't they? Sort of The Age of Excellence. Stellantis. Now I'm hearing a bit of Robert Miles.
Children Robert by Miles? Robert Miles. Children. Ever so slightly retweaked hastily because of the rebrand. Stellantis. Yeah, that could work.
So very sort of twinkly piano led, but then the difference with Stellantis. Okay, in at number four this week, they've got the sax player. Just doing a little bit of parping over the top as well.
It's a very strange name for the group that culminates merging Vox. Let me get this right. Vauxhall, Citroen, Peugeot, Fiat, Maserati, Ferrari?
No,
Ferrari aren't part of Stellantis, aren't they?
No. They've sort of been...
They had a massive bust-up. What tour was it when they just went their separate ways?
I think the tour was called the Infinite Sky Tour, wasn't it? Something like that. But
is there anybody else I've missed out in Stellantis?
Yeah, there's Alfa Romeo. And technically Lancia as well.
No, it was the hand... it was the Hand Beyond the Veil tour.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, it was a good one. Yeah.
Has an Amy Grant sample in there somewhere.
It was amazing. In fact, I've still got the CD wedged in a multi-changer that I tried to fish it out with some old stick, but I can't get it out. Sadly.
Is that the first CD you ever bought that had a clear spine rather than a grey ribbed plastic one? Like, this is novel. They put a bit of picture inside the spine of the CD.
It's quite bad, isn't it? I've still got all my old CDs. Still got my first CDs. I'm still very... In fact, I dug out my first CD the other day to play some of the tracks to my kids, and they looked at it like it was like the Doomsday Book. It's amazing. I said, oh, come on, it's got Move Any Mountain by The Shaman in it. It's not that bad. Come on. Cheer up.
It's got Verge of the Eclipse by Stellantis on it. Remember that? 98. Summer. Brilliant.
Oh, yeah,
number
it has.
Two, I think it got to. There's loads of... I mean, basically, name a car company and there's a 64% chance they're in Stellantis because it's... I mean, it's huge. Jeep's in there.
Of course,
Chrysler,
Jeep's
Dodge
in there.
And Ram and... which I think are the same thing, and
forgot about Chrysler being in there. Yeah, so actually, they're doing everything from electric Fiat 500s to Hellcat V8s. Blimmin' heck, what a wide! I mean, if they were indeed a musical act, what on earth the genre would be? I don't know.
Oh my God! Well, it's sort of from Italo House at one end to country and western at the other.
Yeah,
and that's a couple of genres that have never crossed over. So.
Yeah, and in between, it'd be Mike Oldfield on LSD. bass jumping from inside a warehouse. Keeping it nice and risky. listen, Mike, this is not high enough for the parachutes to work. It'll be fine. Let's just do it.
It's okay. I've got a keter. it's deranged how many car companies there are, and certainly in Europe how much it all overlaps. And last week they officially came into being. I know it's been on the cards for ages, but last week I guess some bit of paperwork was signed, and as of whenever it was, I can't remember the date, about the 18th or something.
Yeah,
about
10 days ago.
Stellantis.
Did you know it was going to be called Stellantis? Because I know you're...
Yeah. They publicised it a while ago and then announced their Eurohouse Act logo. And
did they announce it via fax or very early email? Because I didn't see that. Have they got an Hotmail customer service address?
Yeah. Stellantis@hotmail.com.
Oh gosh, I feel like I need to buy that now.
Have you? We talked about this before. That it's always something that I always go, oh, you let yourself down a little bit there. When you see like vans, and it'll be sort of called Elite Home Tiling Limited.
Yeah,
and then their email address on the van is elitetiling47@gmail.com, and you just go, come on, you've got a website, you can route the email through the domain name. It's like, it's doable. Why did you not do it?
It's just the busy guys. They're busy, they got stuff.
Ultimate
on.
Plumbing Services Limited, the first for excellence.
Stellantis, PSA FCA 12234@hotmail.com. Do you know what we're mocking?
Could you not get the domain? What happened?
Do you know what, I'm actually...
Yeah, it always always bugs me that.
I might get a Stellantis T-shirt. I don't know if they'll do them yet. Might get one.
Well, you should lobby them.
And strictly listening to Guru Josh Infinity whilst wearing it. With, you know, with those... is it Orbital that wore the glasses with the torches on the side?
Yes.
In fact, Orbital are probably going to do a Stellantis unveil at some point. Aren't they? You imagine it being really moody. It could work.
Didn't Orbital fall out? Because they were brothers, weren't they? And I think they might have fallen out.
All right, what about half of Orbital?
But which half? What if they're both touring as Orbital in some kind of bitter legal struggle, like a lot of those? Like, aren't there like two Bucks Fizzes?
There are.
And
there's two UB40s.
Oh, God,
because there's one with Ali Campbell.
That's like two more than the world needs. Which
Red Red Wine Remix by Stellantis. Yes, Euro Uplift. Bombastic.
I would have left the saxophone off that one, but they chose otherwise. So. Yeah, anyway, no, I don't know. The Stellantis thing baffles me. Well, it doesn't baffle me. I sort of see why they're probably what they're reaching for. But Jesus Christ, it's like in Europe, you've got so many overlapping car makes.
Yeah, it's interesting.
And I'd be interested to see what they did. Because when... what are they called? See, I've forgotten their name. PSA. Yeah. Bought Vauxhall Opel.
Yes.
One of the first things they did, for very sensible reasons, was that they halted the new Corsa and shifted it so that it was based on the same chassis as the Peugeot 208 and the Citroën C3 and all of that. So, which is very sensible, economies of scale. That's how platform things work, isn't it?
It is.
But, and I'm just intrigued to know whether they're going to now do this to Fiat, and there will be a return of the Fiat Punto, which old Sergio Marchionne just let wither and die.
Yeah.
It which was bizarre, because you think, I know they've got the 500, but Fiat used to sort of own small cars, and the 500, what's it called, 500L is
the
no
500L is
Punto
is
substitute.
A terrible car, really. Yeah,
really,
it's a very awkward
car, the fact that people stood in a room and looked at the clay model and went, that's it. That's it, guys. There we are. Sign it off. It's extraordinary that
only
could happen. Particularly the stretched one.
The stretched one is it called the XL or the L? Yeah,
I think so,
it's,
yeah.
I mean, only Peter Kay bought one, as far as I know. And even then, he put it through the book, so it was just claimed a bit of tax back because he bought two of them in case he was going to smash one up. Yeah. I know, it's just a very, very odd car. And the thing is, although the 500 is a fantastic car, they haven't got a great deal of other stuff, have they, really?
No. It's extraordinary. Like, what do the people at Fiat's R&D place actually do? Because I suppose they've been a bit busy doing the 500E, because that's an all-new
500E's
car.
500E's really good, too. They've done a good job with it. I enjoyed that driving that. And it's a smart piece, you know? Smart piece.
Smart piece.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to seeing more from Stellantis, and actually I have a Stellantis long-termer coming. In fact, it will have arrived.
Do you?
I do, yeah.
What have you got?
I've got an electric Corsa.
Have you?
Yeah, about to arrive on the drive. Yeah. Going to be living...
Interesting.
Yeah, so maybe I will get a Stellantis T-shirt after all.
I just saw a new Corsa, not an electric one, but I just walked past one yesterday, and it's funny because I just feel like you're not seeing them around much. And... I don't know whether that's... It feels like Corsas are everywhere, aren't they? Maybe it's because it's quite a nice-looking car, by and large, and it doesn't sort of look like the old Corsa.
No, it doesn't, which I'm glad about, because I've never really liked the look of the Corsa. This one looks like the last generation Audi A1. to me, in a good way.
Oh, it does a bit. Yeah, yeah. You know, that's a nice looking car, isn't it? The old A1, I always thought it was an underrated bit of design.
It is a good,
before Audi went a bit,
I think it's one of Audi's
fiddly,
most tasteful vehicles.
Yeah, there's one lives down the end of my street in a really sort of nice undercoaty grey colour, and every time I walk past it, I just kind of go, that's good, that.
Yeah.
That's a good bit of work. Good bit of design. Neat.
It is a very...
But sort of...
Yeah.
It's, you know, sort of small cars. Small cars can be a bit sort of over cutesy sometimes, and it isn't. It's not aggressively macho, but it's not overly cutesy either way. It's a good sort of compromise between the two. Anyway, I was going to say I really enjoyed your Garage Find Volvo film on your Late Break Show channel.
Oh,
and it reminded me of something when you were talking about pushing it out of the garage, and I think it was you said that some of the neighbours remembered the guy who owned
yeah.
it pushing it onto the drive sometimes to just sort of give it a clean and then pushing it back in.
Yeah, yeah.
And it reminded me of what my dad used to do, because my dad was a big push the car out of the garage onto the drive, even if we were going somewhere. And I'd completely understand why, because I hate, and I know you hate as
yeah.
well, like turning an internal combustion engine on for like 30 seconds.
I have cold. A real just... thing about it. Yeah, cold start, like start stop thing. I think oh, by the way, if you can hear really powerful wind and stuff, there's a storm going on. In fact, it's probably Storm Stellantis. I haven't worked out what name this storm is. They've always got names.
Coming in off the Stellantis.
Yes,
station.
it is. But
everything's Stellantis,
yeah,
now.
It is.
Fiat, Vauxhall, winds. generally, they've bought everything.
I know. I think it comes down to the mechanical sympathy thing. And when you mentioned it to me, I was like, I would do that. And I get mocked about it because people are like, what?
Do you?
Do you really? Are you being
yeah.
serious? Like, I've actually nearly put my back out trying to push a heavy automatic car on a gravel drive before, because it's like, I'm not going to start it for 10 seconds. I just don't see the point.
Johnny, it's uphill, you'll never do it. I've got to,
but I've done it. Do you know what? it's one of about three reasons why I try and stay relatively fit. It's so that I can still push cars so rather than start them for short distances. I just think, especially older cars. Let's take my Dodge, for example. I can't stand starting that up just to like take it out of the garage and move it 10 meters.
Yeah.
I just be like, I'm over. I don't want to do it. I just can't be bothered. Especially if it's cold. It's just not. I feel it's not fair. And yeah, I think your dad had a. He had a good idea. He had a good. Well, I think my dad.
Well, it's funny, isn't it? Because we're both sons of engineers.
Yeah.
So I think it's a hand me down, isn't it, from our respective fathers? Although neither of us are engineers, we inherited a little bit of their engineer
mind.
Attitude
yes.
towards mechanical sympathy. Although that said, you turn steering wheels when the cars are stationary, which my dad told me not to do.
I do it.
Your track rod ends.
I do it.
That goes through me.
Yes, but my track rod ends aren't made of after
it.
Eight, so it's okay.
Well, maybe you should follow the example of my dad and buy a Solara, and then you'll be
do
more
you know
sympathetic
what?
Towards the track.
One day
end.
I would very much like you to buy a Talbot Solara, just so that we could do some kind of Smith and Sniff road trip in it. I just think it because I know they've got very pillowy interiors, haven't they?
Incredibly tappety engine, though.
Yes, I remember that
like,
well.
I remember once a friend of my dad's came over and he'd got. I think he'd got a 5 series. He'd bought a 5 series. It was quite exciting in
yeah.
itself back in the 80s, you know. I was like, that's a fancy car. And it was, must have been late 80s because it was an E34. And going out for driving that and just like thinking I might have gone deaf or something because it was so smooth and quiet inside compared to my dad's tappety Solara. Which was then shortly afterwards replaced by a Peugeot 405, which again seemed smooth in comparison, but nothing like a straight six.
I mean, there's no comparison in terms of kind of in terms of refinement and engineering, is there? But then again, the BMW was probably triple the price. I might be wrong.
Oh God, yeah. But I mean, that's the thing, the Solara was exceptional. it was extraordinary. You just didn't realise it until you sort of had something to compare it to. But the thing about pushing the car at the garage, it only occurred to me after I'd seen your Volvo film, and I started thinking about it. I started thinking what my dad used to do, which was, if we were going somewhere as a family, he would probably, while we were still faffing about getting ready, go outside, open the garage, push the car out onto the drive, and close and lock the garage. And then, when we were all ready, we'd all go and get in the car, and then the car would be started and the journey would commence. And it was almost like a ceremonial getting out of the car, like getting the car out of its box. And I just thought, it's weird that he didn't just wait till we were all
and
ready
then
to
just
go.
Just open the garage.
And then just open the garage, start the car, back it out, let everyone get in, because there wasn't room to do that on both sides in the garage. But that's fine. It could idle on the drive for the sort of 30 seconds
or everyone
got
in. Yeah.
And then just set off. It's and I don't know whether it's partly because it was something to do, because, again, my dad was an engineer and an unfussy man. He would probably just get ready by going, right, I've got my shoes and my coat on, I'm off. And small children faff about.
They're annoying.
And I don't know whether it was that. And it was like, there's something to do, I'll go and I'll do the ceremonial getting out of the car. Or whether there was some other process that I was not party to. Only in retrospect, I sort of went,
it's a very strange ritual. I think in that instance, I would start the car when everyone's nearly coming out of the house and locking up. Is it because did he have to do a ceremonial locking up, and that took time, and that would annoy the family?
There's a bit of locking
up. I do ceremonial locking up, and it annoys the hell out of my wife, because she thinks it takes too long. And I said, well, we've got a lot of doors, so just want to make sure that they're actually...
So our house growing up had your trad up and over garage door, but what you could do with it is a pre-lock. So you did a 90 degree turn of the key, turned the handle, and once you'd done that and released the catch and opened it a tiny bit, then you twisted the key back the way it had come, and then it was pre-locked. So when you closed it again, it was already locked.
I've used it. How useful it is.
Yeah.
On 60s, 70s little, suburban little garage pre-lock doors. Yeah.
Jesus Christ, they weigh a lot, though, don't they, ghost garage doors? And I know this because ours came off once unexpectedly, and I had to sort of grab it and then went, oh my God.
Yeah.
Like, this is not long before we sold the house. But yeah, as an adult, I found myself holding a garage door with a sudden.
Did yours have the counterweights down the side, which were just cylinders of concrete?
It didn't.
Some of the old school ones.
It just had springs.
Mine's got springs, and one of my springs came unhooked a couple of months ago, and the door went sort of 45 degrees. And I nearly had it, and my heart nearly skipped a beat, and he landed on one of the cars.
Growing up, one of our neighbours used to do a strange thing, which, I mean, talk about giving burglars a nice clear signal as to what was going on, but if he was just popping out for a bit, he would open the garage door, get his car out, and then he would close the garage door, but not all the way. He would leave it probably at sort of almost like a 45 degree angle, so it was neither open nor closed.
So it was obvious it was open.
Yeah. Oh no, it was like really obvious. It was like there was a 2 foot gap easily between the bottom of the garage door and the floor.
Right.
It was like, but you wouldn't go, that garage door is open, but you wouldn't say that garage door is closed. It was like Schrodinger's garage door, because it was, you just go, but what it meant was, he just popped out somewhere locally. He wasn't going to be long, and clearly he couldn't be bothered when he got back to go through the unlocking process.
How bizarre.
But he would get out of the car. I mean, you might as well just leave the garage door open completely. But no, the semi-close, which signified I won't be
But it could baffle would-be burglars, because they might think, well, hang on, in that sort of old-school way, Dad could be out in the garage, I don't know, about to cut some wood / smoke a roll-up cigarette without anybody knowing, and he's just opened the base of the door to get any fumes out. You know, let's say he's starting up a two-stroke strimmer with the garage door mostly closed whilst smoking a Hamlet cigar. You know, obviously there's a few fumes that need to get out of there. And we've all done it. We've all smoked a chubby cigar whilst starting a two-stroke, like, lawnmower or something. Yeah, it's I don't know, it's very the rituals are weird, aren't they? I wonder if anybody else remembers strange rituals. There are probably less rituals now, because cars don't even get put in garages so much now. In fact,
that
my neighbour, who I can see his garage from where I'm sat recording this, he's in a retired engineer, I've probably told you before, for heavy plant engines. And he swears by diesel. He's a massive DERV fanatic, and he's had a string of Skoda diesels. He starts his car up and barely waits for the engine to catch before it's in reverse and it's coming out of the garage from cold, and then he'll turn it off to go back in the house to like lock the house and to then shut the garage door and then start it again. So it's the absolute opposite of what I believe in, and I have to ignore it because I get a little bit stressed out. Although,
have you ever thought of putting an anonymous note through his door? I must complain as strong as possible. So we'll write it with your other hand. And don't sign it, obviously. Where's that note from? Oh, it's from that bloke next door, Johnny. But for some reason, he's done it in child's handwriting.
As a neighbour, it's come to my attention. He'll look around and go, I've only got one neighbour.
Yes.
I wonder who that could possibly be.
It's come to my attention is a fantastic way to start any slightly snippy neighbourhood complaint. Yeah, I had one from I had an email from a person on our street complaining about the number of cars that I'd parked on our street and where I'd parked them, and she started it with, I'm writing to you as your neighbour. And I was like, well, of course you are. I'm writing to you as the actress Angela Lansbury, because that wouldn't be true.
Maybe
like,
she's encouraging
really
role play.
Weird.
I'm writing to you as the woman in black that hides behind the bush and stares at you between 8 and
I'm
9.
Writing to you as an attractive lady scientist in a 1960s film about space. Okay, whatever you want. Yeah, that was weird, but it was going to. She used a lot of very snippy neighbourhood dispute language. And I was going to write back, dear so-and-so, please fuck off. But then I thought, no, I don't want to cause trouble. So I killed her with kindness instead. And that seemed to work quite nicely. And the matter was resolved.
Killing with kindness works.
But, you know, the reason that I didn't want to have to give in to her, not, you know, so I could see her point to some degree. But the reason I didn't want to completely give in to her demands is because it would have meant moving my cars, which would have meant starting them for about 30 seconds to shift them around the corner, which goes back to our original problem.
I know. Are we just weird, Rich? I do worry
we
about
are a bit
my behaviour in that respect. Now that it's been brought to my attention in the public domain, I wonder if I should hang my head. Although, back in the old days, of course, oil technology wasn't as good. I remember my dad drilling it into me that the first 20 seconds of a car running is where the most wear takes place. So be careful. And he used to always say, you know, strike it up, just give it 30 seconds to catch its breath. In that time, put your belt on, I don't know, do some demisting, put a CD in, whatever. and actually I do still do that. In fact, I was filming with my Tokyo Nissan Cedric taxi this week, and the weather was really cold. And because it's LPG, I do like to warm it up a little bit before I get it going. And it only, because it's got a Japanese radio in it, it only picks up one radio station in the UK, and if that's playing a crap song, I'm like, oh.
Japan FM.
You know, it only seems to pick up like BBC Radio Cambridge, and
really,
yeah, it's rubbish. BBC Radio Cambridge is mostly rubbish. So what I find myself doing is, it has a cassette deck, but it doesn't have a CD player. And I've only got one cassette, which I got as a bit of a joke 40th birthday. So I put the cassette in, and it does play it really well. I have to say the quality's brilliant. But I have the choice of a rubbish radio station or one cassette. Which is Roxy Music, Avalon. Yeah.
I mean, it could be worse, couldn't it? It could be.
Yeah.
It could be something terrible.
It could be
like that Michael Bolton song you mentioned to me last week.
Oh yeah,
was it Steel Bars? Which of course I went.
You
and
did go
to,
and listen to it, didn't you?
And it became a total earworm, and I had to listen to it again. And God, it's a big production, isn't it? Jesus Christ! It's like, because the first time I listened to it, I was like, oh, it's got a breakdown. That's nice, but the breakdown goes then straight back up into a key change. You just go, fucking hell, he's thrown the kitchen sink of MOR music at this. It's extraordinary.
You know, I thought you'd appreciate that, and I did chuckle, because I thought, I bet you're listening to it in a slightly dishevelled spare room where you're working at the moment, wearing clothes that you normally wouldn't go out in because you're working at home, so you just want practical warm clothes, let's say, working at home fleece. And you're listening to a really powerful ballad by Michael Bolton. And funny enough, I hadn't heard that song for ages, so I listened to it, and then I shared the music video with you, which was one of those music videos where they just use snippets of live stadium tours, which I do quite like. And yeah. Then I found
Is a bit of black and white as well.
There was some black and white, which was mostly the slow motion.
Some black and white.
I think it was mostly the slow mo in black and white. And he wore at various times one of those baseball caps with a steel plaque on the front. Do you remember those?
Oh,
they were crap.
Janet Jackson was a big fan.
Right. Yeah, it looks like one of those things that you either put on a house that's of historical significance, or a gravestone.
I always think it just looks like you'd accidentally sit on the cap and bend the metal bit, and it would never be the same again, and your cap would be ruined.
Yes, actually, you've just
shit. We've got to get out of here. I've just sat on Michael Bolton's hat.
I've straightened it right out. I've just had a thought. You know those plaques that they do put on buildings saying this is where Mozart wrote his famous hit that then Stellantis used in 1997.
His famous hits. I've never heard
what classical music
referred to as writing
blockbuster.
Hits, but maybe they do. They might do on classic FM.
Well, again, but imagine if those plaques could be used on cars that are parked around the place. You know, you were talking about the Honda Jazz that didn't get moved, and you don't really know who owned it. If you were allowed by law to put plaques on cars like that, so 2012 Honda Jazz hasn't moved from this point since X, VIN number, blah blah blah. And you can just walk around, and it's a bit like you could do like a more interesting version of Pokemon Go, where you just walk around a city and go, oh, okay, so somewhere down one of these streets, I'm pretty sure that there's an insignia. With one wheel missing, and someone's drawn a dick on with a key in the paint on the tailgate. I want to go and see it.
Because I was thinking walking tours like they do sort of around city centres to look at those blue plaques. But yeah, a Pokemon Go style, find some interesting
cars. I'd love to do a Pokemon Go style thing for like semi-derelict cars. I think it'd be brilliant.
We should.
I think it could be brilliant. It's basically just a series of pin drops now that I think about it.
You've got to do it in quite a lo-fi way, relatively. Don't get
But I might, might record voiceovers for each one, though. I might do that.
Like an audio tour of a museum.
So once you've got to the car, press this button, and I'll do a kind of Attenborough-style, breathy, atmospheric description of what you're looking at. So it would be, I don't know, the joy-ridden Nova SR that's returning to Earth in the wood just outside of Durham. Yeah.
You've just reminded me that ages ago on a Smith & Sniff video, we were talking about Attenborough and I think trying to describe his voice, and you rightly said it's quite breathy. And somebody got in touch or left a comment and said that in his family, I think, said they always describe Attenborough's voice as biscuity.
Biscuity.
And I thought that was really good. Yeah, I think it was based on the fact that if you eat a lot of biscuits, you get that slightly clammy throat. Like digestives or something. You know, you really go to town on a tube of digestives. And you get a bit. And I've just had far too many digestive biscuits. And
it would be
hard to speak properly. Biscuity.
He's shut in a sound booth. He's got six Gary Boldy and a thimble of water. What are you going to do? It's like a panic room scenario. Oh, and by the way, you didn't have any breakfast and you ran to the studio. So you're a bit like, you're hungry, you're tired, you need some energy for the voiceover. What does one do in a situation like that?
Biscuity.
Yes, here we have.
How was that take for you? It's a bit biscuity.
Yeah, just ever so slightly.
So David. Oh, so perfect, you mean? Yes, that's right.
Amazing.
Yeah, I was going to say, since you mentioned the Honda Jazz, and we have been talking about hills that we will die on, not starting cars for a very brief amount of time, I've realised there's another hill that I will die on in the car world, which I was prompted by seeing a new shape Honda Jazz yesterday. Have you seen these?
Yes. I actually quite... If it's the one I'm thinking of, I quite like it. It's...
The standard one comes with like a sort of grill-less, snubby nose, which looks quite odd. And also, you can have it with black wheels, but with a... or rather, sorry, you can have it with shiny wheels, you know, or silver coloured wheels, but they have a black rim. The rim is blacked in, so they look very odd. Not bad, but
distinctive.
Quite mad.
Yeah, they're not like Toyota new shape Prius and Mirai odd, because that's just silly.
No.
But I do actually quite like that. I quite like the new Honda CR-V. You know, it's been out about a year now, I think. But quite like the shape of that, because it kind of looks like when Japanese cars were trying to ape American cars, but on a scaled down size.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that. There's something a bit interesting for me there. There's an appeal.
The Jazz also has that sort of all-road / streetwise version. The Cross Star, you've seen this, which does have a grill, weirdly, and is sort of, you know, wheel arch extensions and all that. I was going to say all that jazz, but that's
you could have said that.
But all that stuff. But the reason I bring it up is because the Honda Jazz has something that I firmly believe never, ever, ever works in car design as well as it should do. It has a fuel filler flap where two of the edges meet other styling features of the car. In this case, the back light also is like the trailing edge of the fuel flap, and the top edge, I think, is the bottom of the window line. And that never works. Fuel filler flaps should float in space on a panel, is my view, because it always looks a bit shite when they don't. The last shape Focus had the same thing. Doesn't work. Probably looks all right on a clay model, and doesn't look all right when you have to make a car and it has to have a gap around it.
I know what you mean. Cack. I don't like it when there's nearby lines which it doesn't follow. If it's going to be near a door shut line or a window line, there should be some relationship. And I think one car which it's done that very badly from memory is the new Peugeot 208, which is actually a really good car. But from memory, I think the filler door is just in this weird space where the shape doesn't go with anything around it, and it annoys me. I'm going to have to now check, because
I think that new 208 is quite a nice looking car.
It's a great looking car.
When you get close to one, there's a bit of business happening that I feel like there's a point at which they should have stopped, and they sort of didn't. They just did a little bit extra. You know, it's got that like funny little thing on the rear pillar.
Oh, the little indent, which has an E on it if it's electric.
And it's just a bit, you go, I think you didn't need that. I think you could have got away without it, but you carried on. It looks okay in pictures, but in real life it's
I'm quite down with that, you know. I'm quite down with that, yeah.
Are you? I think it's because...
Is it 'cause I'm a wrong'un, Rich?
No, maybe the pillar would look really boring and plain without it. I don't know. It doesn't, like, completely wind me up, but it's just I saw one the other week and I just went... You just kept adding. I've just looked up a picture actually of the 208, and you're right, the fuel filler is a very it's an odd shape.
It's an otherwise really good car and a good piece of design, I personally feel.
Peugeots have got quite pretty again.
They've got brilliantly pretty. I'm really into them at the moment. I think they're doing good things.
Good.
The 2008, the 208.
And of course, they're part of Stellantis now. So I'd imagine they'll be doing a residency in Ibiza this summer.
I'm thinking maybe Peugeot. They're going to headline, you know, Club GAY. They're going to go for the kind of the uplifting side of Ibiza, the more kind of gender fluid side, I reckon. That's their aim. Yeah. If Stellantis is going to pigeonhole people, that's probably what they'll do. I feel like I'm going to have to make a Stellantis t-shirt, just because I think the vast majority of the population will have absolutely no idea. When they look at the logo next to it and everything, they'll go,
"No idea.
Is that a make of like guitar amp?
Is that deodorant?
Is it one of those fitness things like Peloton? Is it? I've just done 50 minutes with Stellantis. So have you? Yeah, I bet you did. Yeah,
well, you got to go. No, it's just my phone buzzing to tell me I'm behind on my Stellantis regime for this week.
Just so many options there. It's just out of control, mate. Yeah, right. Yeah, I sound like I'm being down on the Stellantis. I'm not. I'm actually quite excited for Stellantis. And in fact, I've just realised I've got a Stellantis product on the drive right now. It goes back tomorrow. I've got an electric van, and it's really, really good. It's one of the coolest cars. I say cars.
Electric van?
Yeah, I've got a Peugeot e-Partner on the drive.
E-Partner?
Yeah, e-Partner. Oh. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's... Yeah, and it's, of course, it's...
like Castrian cowboy. Okay. It's good, is it?
It's really good.
I thought you had a cab. Were you not running around in a electric London...
Yeah, that went back day before yesterday.
Oh, right. God, it's like Johnny's Car Supermarket.
I'm trying to get them in as much as possible because of restrictions, and it's hard to make content, so I'm just trying to... You know, get the cars in.
Was that a cab you had, or was it the van version of the cab?
It was the car because I couldn't get... I haven't driven the van yet. I've had a look around it and a sit in it, and it's really good. Mm. But do you know what? The car, I've driven it a lot. I've been fortunate enough to borrow it a few times in the last couple of years. But I did a little bit of filming with it, and I let my wife drive it. Because I needed to do some shots with two cars for the video, and she loves it. I said, you know, you can buy civilians can buy them. You can you can just buy a London electric vehicle company black cab for a family car. And I was like, I'd love to do that.
Mm.
And they're going to make a camper van version.
I saw this.
Yeah, and I can't wait for that either. I just think it's a really good product. It's beautiful driving position. Really smooth, excellent visibility, well made. I don't know, I'm just quite into it. And it does look better than a Rolls Cullinan, so it's like, well...
yeah, there's...
I mean, that wouldn't be particularly hard.
I was going to say, yes.
In fact, yeah, I've got a semi-abandoned bathroom suite at the end of my garden that possibly looks better.
Semi-abandoned?
Well, I am going to clean it up and put it on Gumtree.
Oh, so it just implied that maybe you were still using part of it. I'm sure some
local badgers are probably using it, but it's new old stock, but I've just left it outside since last April, so... I need to clean it up and put it on Gumtree, which sounds like a euphemism, but it's not.
In this context, yes.
Yeah.
I wanted to say thank you to listeners who dived in after last week's show to suggest cars that I might want to buy as our next family car. People got quite into that, and interesting sort of factions, people who went, yeah, you should get a supercharged Range Rover. Actually, not that many people said that, because there are a lot of people who went, I used to have a Range Rover and it broke all the time.
Of that genre,
but then there are a lot
of
people who, I think there's a lot of people who don't know, either know what a dog is, or at least don't know how big my dog is, because they were just sort of going, oh, you should get a Lancia Gamma Coupe or something. You're like, no, I got a dog, have a dog, two children, dog and children, can't do that. Yeah. Oh, you should definitely, you should get a Caterham. That's what, that'll be your solution. But thank you for everybody.
What about a Dutton Ranger? just for sheer punishment. Do you know what? They're probably, you les don't even know what they are. They just go, oh, fuck it, just let him drive in.
It's too complicated to work this one.
You're allowed in, but don't put it on choke. So make sure it's always hot started. It's running better.
But what it reminded, because a couple of people at least recommended XJ shaped Jeep Cherokees.
And, they did.
And I've already had one of those.
Yeah.
And it set me thinking. I was suddenly like, I don't think I've ever owned the same model of car twice.
Oh, that's a really good question. Because as soon as someone did I did say, oh, Rich has already owned one of those. And actually, you bought one when they were worth nothing. They're actually going up in price now because they're considered
modern
classics.
Yes.
Or retro cars, I suppose you call them. Have I owned the same car twice? Yeah, of course I have. I've owned various Mark II Golfs, a couple of Mark I Golfs. Oh, I've owned three Mercedes 124s. I've owned three Mercedes 123s. Yeah, so I have. I mean, slightly different model spec, you know, if you're going to be really kind of like anorak about it. I've owned a diesel one and a petrol one and a carb one and an injected one, or one with wind-down windows, one with Lecky sunroof, that kind of jazz. I've actually owned...
What? So you'd go back, I'll have another one of those, because this time I want wind-down windows.
My brother's the worst. He's a complete repeat offender for that. He's had the same genre of Passat. How many has he had? I think he's had six. Really? Yeah, he's had six. Yeah, and I told you the one that was called the Egg, the Over. The number plate was OVA, so we used to call it the Egg. And it was a Passat Estate, which was, what era? The one where there's no radiator grill, the sort of aero one of the late 80s.
Oh, yeah.
Or early
late
90s.
80s, yeah.
Of that shape, he had loads, but that one, it was his particular favourite. It was turbo 1.6 diesel, so the small diesel. He bought it off the original owner, and it had done 330,000-something miles with full VAG history. Honestly, he needed a pallet truck to take the service books away with it. It was unbelievable. It had, like, its oil changed like every other day. It was ridiculous.
What, like an American
car?
Or a car owned by an American.
It was just unbelievable. He was amazed. But the thing he said was, I'm only going to use it for commuting, and it's been used for commuting. And sure enough, it was so reliable because it just carried on doing what it had been conditioned to do. And I think that was really important. And also, Odin, what he loved about them is he could buy one for, let's say, my brother never spent more than a grand on a car. So he used to buy one for, say, 800 sheets. He'd do 100 miles a day in it for 3 years. And then he'd sell it for 800 quid. It was just fantastic. He said, I always would just do the cam belt. I'd really clean it, take excellent photos, straight away 800 quid. So it's effectively free motoring.
Fair play.
Yeah, yeah. So I think that's a very convoluted way to saying I have had the same car several times, and I probably will do.
Yeah, I sort of knew that you had. It's just something I don't think I've ever done. I'm trying to think now. But no, I'm pretty sure I haven't.
I'd like you to keep on moving. Makes me feel.
Well, I like that Cherokee, but that's the thing. I feel like I've done it. I should try something else. But
I need to buy more BMWs. I think that's something in the next 2 years. I feel like I need to remedy that. I've never owned a Saab, and I've only ever owned one BM, and it wasn't really a proper one. So I should really buy that. I'd like to buy an i3, and I'd like to buy an E34 5 Series because it's my favourite. But I don't really need one. In fact, I definitely don't need one. So that's why I haven't got one. But I do. It's a bit of a.
They're still around, aren't they?
They are still around. Yeah, yeah. Because they're good. Oh, I know.
And they are quite sort of desirable now amongst BMW perverts.
I wanted to. I know that this comes off the back of that conversation about you maybe getting a supercharged petrol Range Rover as a dog car, which still just sounds so brilliantly first world problem. But I would say. I know I got a little bit cross about it last week, and I want to apologise. I want to say, if you did buy one, I would accept on the condition that we could film some sort of awful B-side versions of the trip, like Steve Coogan and Rob Brydon, but it would revolve predominantly around recalls and breakdowns with said Range Rover, so we never really get to the destinations. We pretend that we're driving in these sort of majestic luxury, but actually all we're ever doing is watching all the lights on the dashboard appear and disappear. Mild power steering failure here and there.
It's funny because I had a few messages from people going, it would start with, I had a Range Rover of that shape, and end with over £10,000 later kind of remarks, you know, with repairs that were more than the car's value, and it still didn't work properly, all these sort of horror stories. But then a Land Rover dealer that I vaguely know got in touch and went, they're brilliant, they're the best Range Rover,
really,
and they don't go wrong as much as people say they do. Yeah. And he's usually pretty brutally honest about stuff, and it's not like he's trying to actually flog me one because they're old now. But he said he prefers them to the current shape, and there's less to go wrong on them as well. But I mean, that's a relative thing, isn't it? It's like getting a smaller dog because there's less to go wrong on it. But it's just like it's a relative thing. So,
well, it's the same with
I don't think I'm going to do anything rash.
They get up.
Oh, but they frighten me. They do frighten me.
But would you like to do a? I'd like to do like a Cuba spec P38, where you buy a P38, you take every single piece of technology out of it, and then you just put a transit diesel engine in it and just run two wires from the front to the back for lights. So you've got the look. You get the look. You know what I mean? I've got the look. It's a P38 Range Rover. They're aging well. It's just fine.
Yeah. And it's good. Why is sitting very low? Yeah, it's because I just stuck a couple of live axles off a Mark II Escort.
Yeah.
The suspension had failed, so it's got leaf spring.
And it's just rear-wheel drive. It's not even front-wheel. It's not even four-wheel drive anymore.
You don't need... Why do you need the complexity? It's silly. Don't get yourself.
So you've got the look. You've just got the look, but not the reality.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. I'm not going to rush into anything because, as my wife has pointed out to me once again, we don't strictly need to get a car in a hurry. Where are we going?
Quite
at the moment.
Quite.
So there we go. Anyway.
So if anyone has a really, really like baggy Range Rover they want to sell, what's the email address that they should have for the Smith and Sniff show again? Definitely.
Yes. Why not? Why not taunt me with tat that you want to get rid of? Do remember, I have a large dog and two small children, and I am about to live in a ultra low emissions zone. So, so don't just go. You should get a Di Tommaso Pantera, mate. But yes, if you want to email us about anything at all, really, it's Smith and Sniff. @gmail.com.
Yeah. It used to be Stellantis123 at Hotmail, but yeah. We've just recently changed it.
Well, it used to be Smith & Sniff at Stellantis.com because they were our internet provider, and they seem to have branched out into other stuff now. Weird. Well, this is probably a good time to start sort of bringing things into land since I've done the email address. Speaking of ways to contact us, if you are feeling generous, we now have a Patreon, and if you want to chuck in some pennies or pounds, then you can contact us through there, and there's a slightly bigger chance you'll get a reply, because I tend to lose emails like an idiot, but you could try dropping us a note through there if you're one of our lovely Patreons, and thank you if you are. Before we wrap up, I have three things to tell you, and they are: one, Johnny has a solo YouTube channel called The Late Break Show. Go on there to see a very excellent barn find Volvo estate film and
Ford Mustang Mach-E
of Ford Mustang Mach-E, yeah. Two, I've got loads of books out at the moment. Spin the Wheel of Shite. Why not buy Steel Flies by Roy Lanchester? It's a spoof Cold War thriller by a fake, I'll call it, car journalist character. And three, although Magnum PI was famous for driving a red Ferrari 308 GTS, the original car the producers had in mind was a Porsche 928. But when they asked Porsche if they could install a bigger sunroof so that Tom Selleck was visible driving during the expensive helicopter shots, Porsche said no.
What?
So they went to Ferrari instead.
Seriously?
True fact.
I kind of wish they had done a 928 now. I like a 928.
It's hard to imagine. Yeah,
that Pasha fabric would probably be quite bad in hot climate.
Yeah. Well, I don't know, would actually.
It?
I mean,
but it wicking. Would it be sweat wicking?
It might be wicking. Wicking's a funny word, isn't it? Always makes me think of Will Smith. Wiki wiki wah. Was written about a very absorbant running top.
Well, and he lives in Miami, or did do, or maybe sung about it.
Well,
once.
He did. Well, we've had this conversation before. It's very hard to tell what the temperature is based on videos for music that around that time that were always shot in clubs in Miami. He's wearing a suit, but the women have bikinis. It's going to read on the exact temperature.
Oh, the thermostat's all over the shop. We got no chance. It's like a game show. Guess the thermostat in a rap video.
Well, he is wearing a suit, but then I notice he's not actually got anything on under the jacket, so that suggests it's boiling in there.
He's got a special wicking jacket. He can actually run a marathon in that jacket. It's just fine. So who needs sports gear and smart gear? Just go for a run in a business
suit. Just combine
suit.
The two. It's time-saving as much as anything else. And because of the wicking, you can still go to a meeting and not look too
don't
sweaty.
Worry, it's merino wool.
As long as people don't see your back.
Which, I don't know what it means. It basically means what the BO smell only comes out 48 hours later.
Oh, don't get me started on that deodorants that say 48-hour protection. You go, who's wearing deodorant for 48 hours and not having a shower? For God's sake. I think I've got one that's 72 hours. And you go, really?
That's when you go to a festival and Stellantis are on, all the other bands are on. It's relative squalor, but it's fun.
You get a real sweat on dancing to Stellantis in the DJ tent, and even your wicking business suit has been overpowered.
Oh, the number of times I've been to a really big club wearing a very, very, wearing a very, very figure-hugging suit. Oh, yeah, happens all the time.
Anyway, well, that's it. We've done all the housekeeping, and now we seem to be talking about sports business suits. So
that's basically an SUV. That's what it is. An SUV in clothing form is a smart suit that's also wicking and you're able to maybe run a marathon in it. That's what the SUV genre is these days.
A wicking business suit. Oh, this is an idea. Once again, we've given away an excellent idea without copywriting it. Who knows?
I don't know.
All right. Well, anyway, there'll be more of this same time next week, Monday mornings for regular podcasts. Patrons get it 12 hours before on Sunday evening, if that's an interesting thing to you, which I'm sure it's not. Anyway, we'll see you again next week. Thanks for listening. Goodbye.
Bye-bye. Right, you wicking business suit.